take it to Facebook. I'll do the basic introductions.
Yes, so we are
and
there
of
now.
Of course, I'll hand it over to Shehnaz first, and then Shehnaz has passed on to Hilly and then to Prithvi.
Yes, so we are live now.
Perfect. Hello and welcome to another episode today with us at IDP. I'm your host, Amit Chaturvedi, Associate Director of Client Relations for UK, New Zealand and Ireland at IDP South Asia. And as I have always been saying, we are always pleased to have some eminent speakers who come from esteemed institutions in the UK who have been sharing their insights on various topics and aspects to know about the subjects and study in the UK. Today, I have got three guests who are from University of Southampton. Two of them are academics and one student who has recently graduated from the university. And it will be a combination of experiences from the academics who will talk about the subject. And of course, the student who has just passed out will talk from his experiences if the students have any questions about his experiences at being at Southampton. So I'm sure the insights which these three speakers will share will definitely help you to know more about what it is like to be at Southampton, Southampton's teaching systems, methodologies, especially on the subject which we are going to talk about. So you will get a lot of details from these three people who have agreed to come on IDP's platform today. So thank you all three of you this afternoon coming on this platform. Let me just do the formal introductions for all three of you. And before then I hand it over to Dr. Shehnaz to take on the session. I always have felt that people who have been on these platforms have actually given us huge amount of insights in giving some key content on subjects. And the subject today we have, or the topic today we have, is the gig economy, a tool for sustainable entrepreneurship. I think something which can relate to the student audiences a lot today. Our first speaker will be Dr. Shehnaz Ibrahim. She's the director of the MSc Entrepreneurship and Management at the Department of Strategy, Innovation and Entrepreneurship at the University of Southampton. My second speaker is Dr. Haley. She's a lecturer in entrepreneurship within Southampton Business School at the University of Southampton. A little about Dr. Shehnaz. She's a senior teaching fellow at the Strategy and Entrepreneurship, where she lectures in the subject areas of entrepreneurship, social and digital entrepreneurship. She joined University of Southampton in 2010. She researched issues of CSR and sustainability on small businesses in developing countries as part of the doctoral research, which she was awarded the Vice Chancellor Scholarship for. She is involved in different research projects. She also supervises a number of doctoral students in these subject areas. She has contributed to the relevant theoretical debates by publishing a number of books, chapters, and presented her work in international conferences. She's a guest speaker at leading business school. She organized and chaired a number of conferences and a regular mentor at the EURAM doctoral colloquium. So thank you very much, Dr. Shehnaz, for joining us this afternoon in India. Let me also take this opportunity to introduce my second speaker, Dr. Haley. And her interests include entrepreneurship system, innovation, technology strategy, and venture failure. Very interesting venture failure, of course, with the kind of startups we do see these days, there are always risks, and someone who can share insight on this aspect will be very unique. Her research is motivated by the desire to understand the new ways in which works get organized. As such, she is interested in the platform economy, networked forums of organizing, and the role that these assume in labor policy. She regularly presents her work at the global conferences. At the Southampton Business School, she leads the MSc in Digital Business Program and teaches postgraduate and undergraduate modules in entrepreneurship and new venture design. Without a further ado, I just want to say welcome to Prithvi as well, who I know is an Indian student at Southampton. He recently graduated from the university, and of course, his insights will be of great value to those who are at the moment contemplating to get into UK in these times, which of course we understand are a bit challenging. But yes, We are happy to have your questions on the chat box, so please use chat box. And I'll hand it over now to Dr. Ibrahim to take on this session, please. Thank you very much again for all of you to joining us.
Thank you so much for this wonderful introduction, and it's such a great pleasure and an opportunity to talk to you today. We are really looking forward to welcome as many as you in Southampton, and we are very excited to talk about our topics and about our programs today. I'm going to share my screen now, and we will start the presentation and the talk. And it will be great if at the end we have an engaging conversation with everyone who is listening to us live. We are going to welcome all your questions and any discussion that you wish. So today's topic is about really studying an MSc degree at our Department of Strategy, Innovation and Entrepreneurship, which is really, as you will listen from Prithvi, and you will also will share with you different stories, it's a step towards your future career because it's a mind opening to what are the different possibilities that you can have in your future. Today, as we mentioned, I'm going to share this talk with my colleague, Dr. Haley, and also with Prithvi, one of our recent alumni from the University of Southampton and from MSc Entrepreneurship and Management. I think you already have a good introduction about myself, so I don't want to talk a lot about who I am. I think we introduced ourselves now, but just also to let you know quickly that I am the director for MSc International Entrepreneurship and Management, and also I'm originally from Egypt, where I got my first degree in business administration, and then I moved to the USA, where I did my MBA at George Mason University, and then I moved, landed to University of Southampton since 2010. I am here, and I am part of the Department of Strategy, Innovation and Entrepreneurship. I do teaching and research in the areas of entrepreneurship and social entrepreneurship as well. Haley, would you like to add anything about the lovely introduction that was made?
Oh, yes, Amit did a very good introduction, but I'll just add a couple of words, you know, from my background, because I actually come to academia from a practitioner background. So my first degree was a master's in electrical engineering that I did in Finland, where I come from. And then I did an MBA at London Business School and actually worked in high-tech management for several years, mostly in telecommunications, so a long time with Nokia, that I know is a very popular brand, or used to be at least in India, and also with the luxury arm of Nokia, a luxury mobile phone company called Vertu. And since leaving Nokia, I have worked as a board advisor for some high-tech startups, and did a PhD at Oxford. And I just recently joined Southampton as a lecturer in entrepreneurship, and I'm very much looking forward to working with you there.
Thank you so much, Haley. We just would like to welcome you from the University of Southampton. We are very proud to be a part of this university and from part of the world-class business school. We are a founding member of the Russell Group University. Russell Group is the research-intensive universities, which means that the lecturer that are going to teach you are researchers who are aware of the recent trends in the different areas and fields in business. And they are going to transfer and communicate this knowledge to you in their teaching as well. We are top 100 university globally, and also in the UK, in the recent list, we are one of the top 20 UK business schools. We are also double accredited, and by accreditation, we mean that we adhere to the highest standards, that international and global standards in education and in research as well. And of course, the location is one of the things that we are very excited about, because we are located in the south. Here is Southampton, and we are just 1 hour away from London, so the weather is mild compared to to the UK weather. So it's not very, difficult weather or anything. So it's just usually the south is very warm and very mild. So we are located in a very interesting place, which is the Southampton itself. The city itself is very active city and also very cozy city that has lots of facilities. It has lots of sports and activities that we can do. At the same time, it's a very an excellent place for studying because it's not very crowded, but at the same time, it is just 1 hour away from London and the airport, so you can travel and go anywhere in Europe just in within 1 hour travel time from Southampton. So we are very lucky to be living in this city and to have the university located at this city. Also, we have different kinds of very historical facilities like the Hartley Library, but also we have very contemporary buildings that students enjoy studying at with different study spaces. And this is one of the new business school buildings that is just across the street from where I am working now and where I'm at my office now. So it's really a lovely, cozy place that we are very happy to belong to. And today's talk, this is just an introduction about who we are, where we belong to, and where we are located as well at Southampton in the UK. So the rest of today's talk, we are going to talk about our department. We would like to welcome you on behalf of all of my colleagues in the Department of Strategy, Innovation and Entrepreneurship. I will go through a tester lecture about the gig economy, a tool for sustainable entrepreneurship. This is a topic that is very close to my heart and to my research. And I was very excited to have this opportunity to talk to you about it. Something that is really relevant and very contemporary and also will open up opportunities for all of us and for all businesses and for all students as well. We will talk to you about what to expect from studying with us at the Department of Strategy, Innovation and Entrepreneurship in one of our MSc programs, and also we'll share with you what's going to be next in your education journey. We'll talk about what students do after their graduation and we'll give you some examples. We will end this talk with a Q&A session, so we are really looking forward to have any questions you have or any comments or any feedback in our talk that you would love to share with us. So this is a welcome from our department. This is in front of the new building that we I just shared with you. And this is the teaching team that are looking forward to meet you hopefully next academic year. They teach different modules and they teach different subjects as well. So you will be able to meet many of them if you decided to come and study with us. For today's topic, I would love to talk to you a little bit about this topic of the gig economy or sharing economy or collaborative economy. You will hear different terminologies that describe the same thing, which is a new sharing economy that we are now living in, that is growing exponentially and that are providing opportunities for different businesses and different individuals who wants to start their own businesses. But not only about that business model, I would love to talk about the link to sustainability and sustainable entrepreneurship. Therefore, for today's talk, we will understand the concept and dynamics of the gig economy, what it is, what are the examples that we can link and we can relate to. We will understand the links to the sustainability and sustainable entrepreneurship. Can a business and can a business model achieve the triple bottom line goals, so become sustainably, financially sustainable, but at the same time, it can have an impact on the environment and on the society. This is what we will discover together today. We will reflect on how can this topic be influential for your future career and or future studies. So we take a broader understanding of entrepreneurship. So it's really, we are looking at entrepreneurship, not only as a topic that is, or as a discipline that is about starting up a new business or starting up or providing a service or providing a new product, but also it's entrepreneurship, it's about creating a social and environmental value beyond this private economic wealth. So can a business be financially sustainable at the same time be environmentally and socially sustainable? This is what we will discover today from this topic and from this the gig economy platform. So with looking at the different platforms that are growing now, I'm sure everyone is hearing about Uber, Airbnb, where people are exchanging now spare spaces, spare rooms, and even spare small couches in their rooms. We are talking about also, we hear these days also about the different platforms. For example, in India, you have what is called Zomato and Swiggy, which are also very popular as I heard and as I knew from in India. Although recently I heard that there are some issues, maybe you can tell me about it at the end of the talk. But all these platforms that are connecting people directly together. They are growing. They are exponentially growing and becoming very popular. What are they and how can they change the patterns and the ways that things that people are using the services and using the products at the same time? This concept was introduced in a couple of decades ago in one of the books that calls What's Mine is Yours. And the idea and the concept of these two authors that did a very interesting TED talk that I can share with you the link was about really, do we need all to use all the things that we have at home and what we use by ourselves without sharing them with someone else? Or can we stop that pattern of consumption that really harms the environment, that really harms the society? And we start thinking about consumption in a new different way. And in the TED talk that you will watch, the question was, how many people have hammer? How many people have a drill in their home? How many times do you use it? So do we really need to own that product or do we need to own the use of that product? So it's about the use rather than owning the material or owning this product or this service itself. So if we think about our consumption that way, is it about the use or is it about the ownership? It makes a huge difference in the way that we look at our products and how we produce products and services. And this is how this sharing economy or that concept created that new platform, which is called a platform-centric design. It's really about connecting the provider, the seller, with the consumer directly. With all the middlemen in the middle, we eliminate the use for them. We eliminate the need for them. Do we really need to have all these middlemen, or can we, as consumers, become engaged in an economy, even at our own houses, even at our own offices? We can now engage and be included in this big platform and in this big economy with what we own, because everyone owes something that they can share with. So this created a new paradigm, a new pattern of consumption, a new pattern of even relationship between buyers and sellers. And with this platform-centric design, we have a new, what is called the new social economy. So in the right-hand side, this is the traditional businesses. The old economy is about providing products and services, existing online services, using of the product and services. But with the new peer sharing economy, now this is combined, we don't have all these middlemen in the middle. We have only the connection between the use of the product and service and the providers. And this is about the two individuals or two consumers sharing together what they have. This is a new economy that is growing now. This is a new economy that is providing opportunities for businesses, for startups, for different individuals to share in it. So what it is exactly? It's a peer-to-peer mainly it's about individuals and individuals. The businesses, the middlemen are eliminated in the middle. So peer-to-peer based activity of obtaining, of giving, of sharing the access of goods or services. So it's really about the access and use rather than the ownership. And it's an economic model that uses what we already have. Why do we need to start, and why do we need to start new products, use more materials, use more consumption, and use more production where we can pollute the environment, use more resources that we don't have much of it left in the environment. Why do we need that? So that's an economic model that really uses what is commonly available. We have lots of things that we can share. It also gives people the benefits of ownership. So you can still own something, but own it temporarily. You don't need to own it for 10 years or 5 years. You can own it for 1 weekend and can take advantage of the use of it rather than owning it and just leaving it in your own spare room, on your garage, or in any storage space. So it gives people this benefit of ownership, but with reduced the personal burden and cost. So instead of buying something new and leaving it, you're just kind of using it for some time, sharing, borrowing it from someone else and returning it back. And we will talk about the different platforms. So it's eerie, really, if you reflect on what you have at home, what you have in office, in your office, what you have in just what people have in different places, you will find that everyone will have something, a bike, an extra boat, an extra space in their car, a mower, something in the garden, even a room at the house. Everyone will have something that they can share that they don't use every day. And the different these platforms are enabled because of this technology. The technology enabled this platform to grow and to really become makes all these transactions easier. So technology has reduced the transaction cost. It makes it very cheap. So just opening a website, developing a website on the smartphones that we have, this technology enabled this kind of transactions, enabled this kinds of access to all these kind of unused and extra spaces and material that you have. It also allowed this transfer of knowledge and the ability to create more and more of networking, the social networks that we have. And that was summarized in what is called the SMACSAC. The SMACSAC is what enabled the sharing economy to grow and to prosper to that extent. Social networks, people now are able to make reviews, do recommendations. So it's building the trust in these platforms. So you are comfortable and you can trust the place or the platform that you are using because people now are online with you. So I are not using only an online platform without having the online also reviews and recommendations. The smartphones also enabled people to use and access all these transactions in a very short and cheap way. All the cloud technology, all the data analytics, all these things, this called the SMACSAC, it really enabled the access, enabled people to engage, whether they are from the business side, businesses to start a platform, or for consumers to share their spare assets that they are having. So different platforms came out of that. So it's not only physical, sharing physical things. TaskRabbit is a very famous platform in the US. It also allows people to share the skills that they have and the knowledge they have. So not only you can share your boat, your space, or a boat or a spare space in your car by car sharing, or a spare room or a space, physical material that you have, but also you can spare the knowledge you have. Someone knows, for example, a specific language and want to teach someone else. Someone knows carpentry. Someone knows sewing. Anyone who has a skill can share it with someone else. And this is what the TaskRabbit was based on. It's an online and mobile marketplace that matches freelancer labor with local demand. So that allows people who do not have a permanent job, for example, to do something on their own time, on their own convenience, with the prices that they specify. So it's not only now the sharing economy limited to platforms that allows people to share their assets, but also share their knowledge that they have and that they can do. One of the platforms that was introduced by one of our students a couple of years ago after being studying about the sharing economy was Meet Neighbor. So this was one of the students who was very interested in that topic. And the idea came to him one day when he was sitting with his friends at night, one of the evenings, and they were bored and they wanted to play with something, a board game. But they realized that they don't have a board game like Monopoly and all these board games that they can play together. So he started knocking the door of the neighbors and went to until one of the old neighbors opened the door and she told him, you know what, I have a spare Monopoly in my house, you know, that my children used to play with. You can take it for now. And then they spent the evening, enjoyed it, and returned it back. And then the idea came to him, and he said, why don't I introduce a platform similar to TaskRabbit, but it's called Meet Neighbor. So it's about neighbors in a specific area or neighborhood that can share what they have and the things that they have through a platform. So very similar to the TaskRabbit, but more it's about physical platform. So that was introduced during one of the studies, during the studies of that specific student. So how about the now looking at this platform, does it really impact this platform, these kinds of platforms and this kind of economy? Can it impact sustainability? In fact, it can. Because this sharing economy or gig economy, it allows entrepreneurs to develop and apply the digital technologies for social good. It can help in eliminating poverty, health, education, human rights, environmental protection. Let's see how does it happen. Sharing economy, it refers to a wide range of practices whose central characteristics are the economic. So it helps people to save some money. Definitely, because they are not using, they are not buying things, they are using only things. It provides also an interesting and novel consumer experience. People are excited to go to and stay in different houses, in different places. It also reduces ecological and carbon footprint because we don't now need to produce more. We can consume more with less production, with less use use of the raw material that we have limited access to it nowadays. It's about really recirculation of goods. So we are recycling what we are having. We are sharing and swapping what we are having instead of introducing new, more things. So an example of that is platforms that are designed and developed in the fashion industry, where these two platforms, for example, one very popular in China, one very popular now in the US, and I'm sure we will have that, and we have also one just recently introduced also by one of our students in the UK. It's about people swapping their clothes. So why do you have to buy more clothes? You can just swap more clothes. And the one that was introduced recently by one of our students is called Switch. So it's kind of like also people are posting some things that they don't need and swapping it with someone else's clothes. So this is an example of, because within the fashion industry, in order to produce one t-shirt, it uses lots of gallons of water, liters of water. So it's really very harmful to the environment, especially in this garment and this fashion industry, which are really using lots of environmental resources that we have. Also, how can these kinds of platforms impact the environment and in fact the economy? But Airbnb, where you are allowed as platforms, enables individuals to stay in the spare rooms or spare houses of other individuals. Because it's now cheaper, that in a study, it shows that now people are more able to travel, of course, not outside the pandemic situation, but now people are more able to travel and stay longer in different economies because the main issue or the main budget that is used in the traveling is the accommodation. And now since the Airbnb allows you to go to a small room, you're not necessarily in a fancy hotel, but still clean and nice and everything, you can still now spend less in accommodation and spend more in any society or any place that you are traveling. So you are spending more, you're going to more restaurants, you are spending more time. So you are really boosting the economic growth of the societies. Couch surfing is another example of platforms that allows individuals to use the couches of people's houses. So that means that these people with spare couches or spare, they can earn money. At the same time, people who are traveling with very limited budget can stay longer and can actually travel. So this is boosting also the economic growth and giving opportunities for people to earn more money from what we have. BlaBlaCar is another example of platforms that allows people to share the rides. So why everyone has to use this, their own car, why they can share a ride to go from Southampton to London, for example. So less environmental pollution, more fun to know different people. And there are, of course, reviews. So they are will be able to trust the person that you are using their cars or sharing their car with. And of course, the ride sharing is, as I mentioned, is very important, and it can costs related to car ownership. So instead of buying a car with all its expenses, you don't need to buy a car anymore. You can just use all these sorts of car sharing. Also the pollution, it also ride sharing can reduce the barriers of car ownership and reduces also the impact on the pollution. There are other platforms also that enables, like Kiva. It gives loans to individuals who wants to start their own business. So person sitting in the UK can give someone sitting in India, or the reverse, someone, an investor in India can give loans to individuals in the UK if they want to start their own business. They simply go and pitch their own platform and or the product they wanted to introduce, or the business idea they want to have. And then if someone, one of the investors like the idea, they simply invest in any at any amount, £1, £2, £3, £100, depending on how much they like the idea and they think that it is a viable idea and it's a good idea. So now these individuals who cannot get loans from the banks because of the restrictions and so on, and they want to start their own business, can get that through platforms even like Kiva. So providing more opportunities for entrepreneurs, for businesses to start their own business. And the impact was amazing. 68% of the people, like they were female, 32% male, and there, it also allowed individuals to start businesses in agriculture, education, food, clothing, retail services. So it's a huge impact on the on entrepreneurship and on businesses who wants to start their own business. A similar one is also called Zupa, who enables individuals to share their own assets and so on. So to summarize this, consumers of shared assets, they can save money, they can cut down on household expenses, they can reduce environmental impact, they can connect to a community of mutual interests, people who can really have share with them the same passion, the same understanding, and the same patterns of consumption. So this is an opportunity for different entrepreneurs to jump into this sharing economy or gig economy bandwagon. The companies are fusing underused assets with peer-to-peer online marketplace. It's booming. Everyone now is trying to get a piece of the pie, as they say. Investments in the peer-to-peer or in these platforms have quadrupled only since it started in 2 years. In 2 years' time, it just became like four times. And now it's like we are talking about billions and billions of dollars is worth these kind of platforms. In the UK sector alone, it's set to grow from 500 million to 9 billion over the next decade. So it's becoming so popular to invest in these sorts of platforms. And it's a huge opportunity for different individuals to use it. So with the development of ICT, with also the growing awareness of individuals about the importance of protecting the environment, of sustainability, of also using a different ways of consumption and production, it becomes an opportunity. Therefore, it's really opportunity for every one of us to think about using, sharing and their own resources, or maybe even starting a business in that digital world. So sharing economy is really, again, it's about the access of sharing one's access capital, rather rather than creating a new capital. And it envisions a future in which people won't outright own many products they use. So really, instead of using, you are instead of owning, you are just using what you have. There are opportunities for entrepreneurs to join the gig economy. And there are also opportunities for existing businesses to expand and to change the way they are consuming their products and services and producing, introducing their products and services, and in order to innovate and become part of this collaborative consumption, because it provides opportunities for different individuals and businesses. So we are really, the world is looking for more zebra companies, and zebra companies are the companies that can actually do good at the same time, do something good for the society, for the environment, and do good for themselves. So hopefully by this talk and by this message, many of you will think about starting up a business or working in a business, in a fast growing business that can achieve this kind of aims, goals, the environment, sustainable, and so on. One of the examples of the students who graduated a few years ago is Damilola, who was very interested in the sharing economy. She started a sharing economy platform. It's called Go My Way. It's in Nigeria, where the problem was people do not have access to transportation. So she started this platform just to help people to really access transportation and use their spare, similar to BlaBlaCar, spare spaces in their cars and help others to do that. Yeah, so this is about the talk. I hope you enjoyed it. And I will move on to talking about how, when studying in our department, what can you expect? You will expect industry collaboration. We are very, we have very close collaboration with the industry, with different companies. We bring them either as guest lecturers, or also like we have lots of career fairs. So it will enable you to connect with different individuals, different companies, small, large, fast growing companies, sustainable companies, so that you can have some opportunities and learn from them and understand what is happening and what is needed in the marketplace. With regards to education, we also are very engaging individual. We are very engaging lecturers. We like to do lots of board games. We do lots of engaging activities with us, metaphor exercises, business simulation and field trips in our education. We also connect with experiential learning platforms like Ripen, where you can actually work in your coursework with actual businesses work as consultants. So your coursework or your assessment is not only theoretical, but also you can provide solutions to companies across the world through these platforms that connects us as educators, as university, with different companies, small and large companies across the world, in order to provide them with some consultation and some kind of solutions for their businesses and their issues that they are facing. Also, we are very active in enterprise. We have different enterprise activities and events throughout the year. We have activities that provide students with seed funding, internship funds, and also 3-day startup, which it helps students to engage and start up their own business ideas. So we're very active in enterprise, and we have, for example, a very strong linkage with different banks like Santander Bank, who provides the 100 Big Ideas. It's a competition where students who really have good ideas, they can give them money in order to start their own business. And some of our graduates from our MSc programs, they actually started their own apps, again, sharing economy apps, because of the through this big competition, and they were able to win the competition and start also their own platforms throughout the studies. We have also the big event, the Dragon's Den event at the end of the year, where after you get engaged in all these enterprise activities, you will get the opportunity, if your idea is really good, to present your work and pitch your idea in front of.
I can't really-
in front of investors in front of these investors in order to get some kind of funds. And we have one of our students who got the entrepreneurship visa and was able to start his own sustainable business, who graduated from us also because of the sustainability issues that he was exposed to. And he was able to start his own business that is very growing now in London, where he was able to use the sugarcane waste and transform it into sustainable paper. Also an example of where students can do and what students can engage with. And this is different examples of our alumni who were able through this connection, through this exposure, through the different activities to secure very good positions, jobs here in the UK, in different positions in different places. So we're really proud of all these things that we are doing. And I'm going to hand it now to Hilly, who are going to talk about our programs and what we offer. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you so much, Shahnaz. So you have heard, you know, what exciting developments there are going on in the gig economy. And you've seen how many of the Southampton students are actively involved in these areas. And if this is something that you would like to do yourself, I have a call for action for you. So we can take a look at the programs that we offer in Southampton and how they enable you to become participants and active influencers in the gig economy. So Southampton Business School offers a broad range of different types of courses, and in the Strategy, Innovation and Entrepreneurship department specifically, we look at all of the four aspects that you heard Shahnaz talk about. So innovation, entrepreneurship and growing businesses, the digital business that underlies the gig economy developments, and the international aspects that you see in these sort of platform type of companies are driving forward. So depending on what areas are of particular interest to you personally, there is a program that is really tailored for your needs. So let's just quickly take a look at each one of those programs. So Shahnaz, if you can move to the next page. So the Strategy and Innovation Management program really focuses on aspects of new product development, global innovation strategies, and just generally strategies of innovative businesses. So if this is an area that is of particular interest to you, this program may be very well suited for your needs. But innovation is also an elemental aspect, of course, of entrepreneurship. And Shahnaz, if we can move again to the next page. The second master's program that we offer in our department is the International Entrepreneurship and Management program. And this program is very interesting because it really prepares you to work in entrepreneurial aspects of business, not just in starting your own business, which of course is what we often think about first when we talk about entrepreneurship, but also in areas like family business, for example, or indeed corporate entrepreneurship. So many companies nowadays, big businesses also are very interested and actively looking at ways of running their business in an entrepreneurial fashion. And this program will prepare you very nicely for that. The program is quite nicely balanced in the sense that it also gives you a pathway into policy roles. So if this is more of interest to you, as well as of course academic work. Then moving on again to the third program that our department offers, which is the digital business program that I am personally heading. And this is of course a topic that is very dear to me because I come from a high tech myself, and I fully agree with Forbes observed already in 2014 when they were saying digital business is everyone's business. And as you can see for Shahnaz's talk, a lot of the developments that we see in the innovation area are built and are grounded really on digital technological advances that are pushing us to think about the world in a little bit different way and also enable us to run our day-to-day lives and our businesses in a different way. And particularly, of course, at the moment in the middle of the pandemic, we see that digital business has really stepped into the game here. So if this is an area where you would like to develop your skills, you may wish to take a closer look at this program, as it gives you a closer feel on sort of aspects of digital business, things like web applications and digitally enabled venture strategies, for example. And then the fourth aspect there, next page again, Shahnaz, the fourth aspect that you heard Shahnaz talk about was of course the international aspect. So gig economy clearly we see is a very global type of enterprise, and our international management program is specifically tuned to help you to develop skills on managing international aspects of business. So whether you are interested in innovation, in entrepreneurship and growing businesses, in digital business, or in the international management aspects, our programs cover each one of these areas and give you quite a nice feel for how you can develop your own careers, whether you want to go into running your own business, or indeed working for someone else, work in policy area, or work in academia. All of those aspects are very nicely covered. If you can move again to the next page. Independent of which program you choose to come from, you join this very dynamic and international community, working together with the different group of people, both academics, practitioners, as Shahnaz pointed out, and of course you saw a very dynamic group of students. So without further ado, next page again, Shahnaz, I want to welcome you all from the program director's team point of view, and also hand you over then to our alumni, who is going to talk to you a little bit about what does this all look like in practice when you are actually in the shoes of a student. So Prithvi, do you want to take on from there?
Yes, thank you. So I just want to share some of my experiences and the reasons as to why I chose Southampton Business School over some of the others, especially looking from a UK context. So this thing about Southampton Business School is it gets all the basics right before we even get started. It's a Russell Group University. It's very well reputed, and it's already in the top 100 universities globally. From an India context, I think we have maybe 5 universities in the whole country that are in the top 100. So Southampton is already, at the very basic level, it's a great university. But going deeper into the business school, the thing that really attracted me to the Southampton Business School is how often they update their modules. So if you are thinking of applying to this university, I would, or any university for that matter, I would highly recommend you look through the modules and all the material that you will be taught that year before you choose a degree or a course. So Southampton updates theirs meticulously, which I found lacking in some other universities, which were very big names as well. So that immediately showed me that, there was something, they were very driven and they gave a lot of importance to the details. Then I reached out to some professors because I read a paper. It was about religion and entrepreneurship with a highlight on Hinduism, which is one of the biggest religions in India. And it was something that was not touched upon anywhere else. So I spoke to him and he was like, yes, over here, you have complete freedom to pursue what you want at Southampton. As long as it's productive, you're given a lot of freedom and a lot of leeway to pursue your own path and, see where it leads to. So that was very, impressive to me as well. Faculty at Southampton are very, very helpful. Like for example, Shanaz, I've spoken to her, I've graduated and I've still spoken to her at least 6-7 times in the past 2 weeks. So that's how friendly the faculty are. And I'm actually on my, trying to start my own company. And this is completely because of my experiences and connections that I made at the University of Southampton. And for me, it was something I'm doing on my own with a little guidance. But for someone who wants to start something or just, considering starting something, the Southampton ecosystem for entrepreneurship is one of the best in the country, if not globally. So there's two things, two incubators they have, or something like incubators. One is Future Worlds, which I think Professor Shanaz touched on. And they have the Dragonstone event, which is like Shark Tank, but in the UK. Where you can pitch for investment. But, Future Worlds is also an on-campus incubator that, helps you, you can access expert guidance, mentors, et cetera, to help you launch your business. And the other one is called the Social Impact Lab, which is very similar, but has more of a specialization on social enterprises, whereas they're not so much for this traditional business as much as they are doing something good for the environment or giving back to the community, so on and so forth. So these two things are, huge bonuses of going to Southampton, especially Southampton. And another thing is, I understand a lot of people are very confused as to what they want to do. I was in the same boat. I still am in the same boat. And the environment at Southampton is very nurturing of that. You can, change halfway, midway through. And, did it stop? Okay, never mind. So you can change midway through. And, if you need help, there's always someone you can reach out to. The professors are all very approachable. For me personally, I started out with wanting to, stay back in the UK and do an entrepreneurship, get an entrepreneurship visa. The university was very supportive of that. They gave me all the opportunities, but then because of the pandemic, I had some situations that required me to come home. That's one example of how accommodating the university is. Another one is I had a very close friend who started at Southampton as a law student. He graduated. Then he decided he wanted to do something in business. He did a master's at the business school in project management. And now he's doing a PhD at Southampton in artificial intelligence. That's how flexible the environment at Southampton is. And also for one person to spend, he spent over 6 years at the University of Southampton now. So that tells you a lot about how good the ecosystem there is for someone to want to spend the entirety of their educational career there, despite having so many pivots. So I only have good things to say about Southampton. And if anyone has anything to ask me, I'd be happy to answer.
Thank you so much, Prithvi, Dr. Helly and Dr. Shehnaz. I think it was a very interesting session because it covers a lot of things which is prompting you to become into the entrepreneur side and think something fresh and new. So what I'll do, I'll just ask one question which is going to be with all three of you because I believe perspective could be changed from one to other. And then I will switch off the Facebook Live session, but we will continue the discussion with the team here. So my question is currently we are living into a very entirely different world altogether. And nobody has thought of this kind of situation will be into the picture a year back. So from the academic perspective, Dr. Shehnaz and Dr. Helly, what's your opinion and advice to international students who are not only in India, South Asia, across the world and planning to make a move to UK and into a dilemma like it is right time or not? And then we will take the perspective from Prithvi that what is his advice to his upcoming mates who are planning from rest of the world to go to UK. So we can start with Dr. Shehnaz and then go to Helly and come to the student perspective, which can be presented by Prithvi.
Yes, thank you. I think it's really the right time because there is with all these impacts and with all these changes that's happening with uncertainty, I see honestly there is lots of people who are going into education more than the job market. So and we can see also usually we don't have lots of for example home students like UK students. Usually they graduate and prefer to go and start working, but we can see that this year it's totally different and people are now interested in doing more further education than before. So I think it's really the right time because the economy is not that great. So, and it's very uncertain as well. So usually, and I'm sure you will find it in different articles and research that with the times of uncertainty, the opportunity for higher education or for further education is much better. So this is really what my advice is about. I think it's really the right time. So, yeah.
Thank you so much. I think it makes a lot of sense. Dr. Helly, your perspective, please.
Great. Well, I would definitely second what Shehnaz was saying. So obviously, this sort of massive shocks are always also opportunities. And clearly, the people who have the skill sets and who have sort of the agility of mind are in best position really to take advantage of the opportunities that are created by situations like this. And this is exactly what we prepare our students for. So you learn the skill sets really that enable you to think about the world in a little bit different way that will then prepare you really for this sort of shocks and actually give you the opportunity to capture those opportunities that lie in the difficulties that we face today. And I think many of our students today actually are telling us that also on our courses. So those people who have joined us do find that actually not only the course materials, but also the way that we work is preparing them for some of the challenges that we face in our day-to-day lives as a result of the current situation.
completely on board with your viewpoint, because whenever we are connecting with our students who went last year to start their studies in autumn 2020, they are saying that they made the right decision rather than waiting and losing on opportunity cost. So thank you to both of you. And now I'll talk to Prithvi, because Prithvi, you have crossed this bridge. You planned the things, you have given the shape to it, and you have crossed that bridge already. So what is your advice to students who are planning right now? Because one thing which you very well said, that if you are planning to study, go through the course content and the modules before you take a call, which is because you have to study eventually. So what else you are going to suggest to international students who are planning to go in this current, and I would say, interesting and challenging time?
So at the end of the day, your value in most job scenarios or really in life is how well you can handle conflict and problems. And this is a perfect opportunity to demonstrate that, or rather learn that if you don't know how to, because it's going to be quite a different experience as what you would have if you went to an on-campus or a completely on-campus learning. Now it's going to be more of a mixed learning. So this is definitely something new and a challenge for you to overcome. And I personally had my first 6 months of completely in campus still from September to March 2020. And from March 2020 onwards, I had completely online lectures. This was the peak of the, you know, COVID, you know, first peak and full lockdown. And I must say there was no drop or noticeable change in the quality of teaching or education at all. It was all our professors. In fact, I would say our professors actually became even more accessible to us, because a lot of friends, classmates of mine had a little bit of stage fright, or they didn't want to stand up and say, but when it moved to an online platform, it was much easier and much less intimidating to voice out your opinion. So if you're one of those people, this is the perfect time for you to take that call.
That's very, very good. So thank you to all three of you and everybody who attended. I will just take this session off from social media. So we'll close the session here, but we'll continue to our chat and we'll take some offline questions. So thank you everyone for participating and joining in today.